Today, in my presentation, I focus on our latest game, on this world mine, and I want to tell you about I want to explain you how it is an extraordinary experience to a player. So, this world mine is a game, or as we like to say, experience. More experience than a game about the civilians trapped in a siege city. Player controls the group of civilians that found shelter in a ruined building. In this hostile environment, player and his civilians will face hunger, will face lack of water, lack of medicine. The ultimate goal is simple. They have to survive the war, they have to survive the ceasefire. So the main game idea came from the Grzegorz Michalski, the head of Eleven Studios. He was touched after reading the diaries of someone who survived the Sarajevo siege. And he inspired us to make a game about this topic, and make a game about civilians trapped in a siege city. We make this game in quite small team. I think it was up to 15 people. And this took us 1.5 years. Since the release in November, we constantly updating the game, we releasing patches, and also we are working on extension for console version. For console version, but this extension to the main game, this World of Mine, the little ones. So now I will tell you about our inspiration. So obviously the first inspiration was Sarajevo siege. It was longest and quite most brutal siege in modern history. The next inspiration, more familiar to us, was also uprising, but not the uprising itself, because the uprising has strong military nature. But we were inspired by reading diaries of Lviv after the uprising, living in the Sea of Ruins. So we have also other inspirations. In modern history, there were tens of sieges. Sometimes they have very different nature, but they have one in common: the tragedy of normal, ordinary people. Of civilians trapped in a dying city. They have every day to challenge with lack of water, lack of food. There were no shops. Shops were closed or looted. There were no pharmacies. So there were lack of medicine. Slightest wound can be mortal. Slightest cold can turn into other disease. The rise of crime and violence, so men with our gun have always right. And this civilian tragedy we want to portray in our game, these naive stories we want to tell. Okay, because the topic we want to approach was extremely tough. We want to approach to this with all the respects and with seriousness. So we took care about deep immersion of a player. We wanted to make in-game character as human as it can be, both the NPCs and the player characters. We resigned from humoristic elements. We don't want to discharge the player from the main game message. We wanted to tell sad, but thought-provoking story. We wanted to give him a sense that war can happen anytime, can affect him and his family, his friends. Our intention was to make player feel that his closest family, his friends, can play a role of these civilians. Because war is a very specific time when people do terrible things, we try not to judge the player at any moment in the game. We didn't want to make a cliché, like good decisions make good consequences and the bad decisions have to be punished. This is not how the world works and our game. Okay, so following the general idea that we want to set our game in any particular place, we have to make some rough assumptions. You cannot create a universal story, for example, because of our architecture. You know, the European architecture is different than the Middle East or Asian. So we make assumption that we set our game somewhere in Europe, somewhere in Central Europe, somewhere in maybe in Eastern Europe. We didn't hint player where it was. We use Slavic names, but the country is we made up this country. This isn't the real country. So we use Eastern and Central European architecture like this. Also, we don't want to hint by what year it is. We assume that the story is happened somewhere in the last 25 years. The player, the characters don't use, for example, cell phones or computers, but the player don't know. It is because they aren't invented yet, or it is because the infrastructure is destroyed. So the color of the graphics, we want to correlate with the sad story. And we limited our color palette. The colors are pale. It is great contribution of Jean-Marc Marshall, our artist director, who was supervised each of the location. Also, we used this artistic trick like pencil effect. We wanted to make some mood and oniric effect. Also, as you can see in the UI layer, we don't use. We also have limited palette. We use only four colors. Okay, 3D models. As I mentioned before, we wanted to make clear sense that the war affects ordinary people like me, like you, like my colleagues from Elementary Studios. And because of that, we scanned themselves and put ourselves into a game. And this is how the scanning process look like. Okay, as you can see, we're using two Kinects, Microsoft Xbox 360 Kinects, and third-party soft called Reconstruct Me. And this was enough to make a scan. But of course, the scan was... we need to work on them, on the scan. Our graphical artist had to clean the scan, normalize it, and then make model from it. After our scanning team gained experience, it took about 30 minutes to scan people, to scan someone, and a few hours to put it into the game. So we used the scanning technology because we wanted to capture this ordinary, everyday person feel. I think the fact that every character in this world of mine is someone of us, someone of our family. It gives the additional depth to the game. We made more than 200 scans of heads or torsos or legs, because we scanned them independently. So this is Momo. He's a journalist who visited us, and so we scanned him and put him into the game. Okay, we also make experiments with animations. Maybe as you can see, this looks very natural because they are both graphical artists. I think they cannot fight, so this looks like this look very natural. But unfortunately, the scanner animations took very long, and we have to work on them. We have to normalize them. We have to clean them. So we also use the classical mockup for animations in game. Okay, so we scan the people. We give their names and we put them into the game. We have 21 characters total, 12 in the original game and 9 in the little ones. And most of them are employees of LMB Studios. So, for example, Boris, who in game is warehouse worker, strong warehouse worker. In real life, he's a designer, also strong. Our Bruno is famous cook. For real, it's Adam, graphical artist. And helpless Emilia, lawyer. It's our office coordinator, Monica. Because in LMB Studios, we have some over-representation of young males. We have to ask for help outside the studio. So, for example, Sveta, the teacher, is our accountant who works with us. And Katia, journalist, is designer's wife. And my favorite character, Anton, university mathematician, for real is a security worker that he works in our building, so we scan him. Okay, so we have 21 characters total, and they have very different backgrounds. We have a retired man who look after his grandson. We have a young girl with a criminal background. We have a firefighter, we have other various operations. Each of the characters has its own unique story that player can discover through the diaries. And because they have different backgrounds, they have different stories, they also have different skills. We intentionally make some skills useless in the game because we want to ask player questions. Do the people as warm as their skills? For example, Sveta is a teacher. He has useless skill during the war, and the player should give her food, or should he give food to someone else, someone maybe more stronger, who will protect the shelter, because everyone has to eat. So each of our characters have parameters, have different set of parameters, like hungry, like mental condition, like physical condition. They can be sick, they can be wounded, and player have to deal with them. Player have to use bandages to treat wounded characters. Player have to use medicines to use these own sick characters, and so on, so on. Don't treat it this. It will. When player don't treat the wound, it will get bigger and bigger, and eventually can cause death of character. So we not only tells the player about the parameters using text on the character card, but we also manifest the condition using behaviors of characters. So for example, characters commands. Our characters command very different things. They command recent events. They command the shelter state, and also they can command the own state. We switch animations for example, character depressed character or wounded character or sick character. Then, if we switch this animation, the character look more suffering. Not only the walking animation, but also the running, the idle animations, and whole set of animations. And when a character is sick or is wounded, he will seek for the he will look for the bed or chair to rest. All of these behaviors we made to. Make player a sense that these people are suffering, to make him feel sympathy for them. And we wanted him to care of this, all these people. But not only the physical condition can neglecting physical condition can result in tragical way. Also the neglecting mental condition. So for example, if player don't look after the mental condition of his characters, it can end with suicide. So we designed the depression point system. Each character can take depression points. Negative events will add depression points to certain to characters, and positive events will subtract these points. So the amount of points define the mental condition of the character. Character can be content, can be in normal state, also can be sad or depressed, and at the end can be broken. If we leave character in this low mental state, like depressed or broken, it's a big chance to provoke trauma events. Trauma events are something like you see before, the suicide. There are other trauma events. For example, the running away from the shelter, the fight between two characters, and battle. So traumas are the next element we use to forces player to treat civilians like normal human beings, not like resources he needs to win the game. So we also made emotional types. We made four different types, emotional types. Each character has assigned one, and we also made some modifiers to them. Cold, anger, wounds, or disease impact all our civilians in the same way, but events like, for example, death of someone affects them differently. In narrative layer, characters make different comments. And they have different they have different notes on the on their diaries. For example, when someone dies, the character egoist, emotional type, will not care, and the altruistic character will care and will be affected by this event. So for us, technically, it was a matrix of values. We have over 130 events, and we simply assign different values to different people regarding this there's emotional type and role, because we have two roles, the observer and the participant in the event. We didn't inform the players about the emotional types of each character, but they very fast find out which character have which emotional type. Okay, so for some time we are working on extended console version of this roadmap. In this version, we will introduce some special signal to us, like the children. Before I introduce some more, this was a teaser. Okay, in the little ones, we want to show the world from yet another perspective, from perspective of a child. We cannot forget that war affects not only adults, but also a child. So we introduce the kids to the game. So we made them a new emotional type. So this will be fifth. Kids are affected much more strongly by the events that happens inside the shelter, happens to them, happens to other civilians, and less by the events happens outside the shelter. They also have other needs than adult civilians. For example, they have need to play. They play with toys. They play with other girls. They need to feel safe. They ask questions, players, adult civilians, and other civilians can interact with the kids, play with them, comforts them if they are sad, and answer their questions. So we made special relation between kid and adults. Kid often choose one of the adult character and establish a special bond. From this moment, the kid will treat this person in a special way. It's often someone close to the kid, like father, or like grandfather, or aunt, or uncle. But it can happen that this person will die, and then, of course, the kid will broke. But after 2 days, we wanted to kid find another protector, another special person that took care of his of it. So the little ones provide some new challenges to the game because kids are very fragile. The player have to take care of them, have to feed them, have to use bandages on them because they can't use them themselves. I think they add another layer or depth to the game, make the game more emotional. Okay, now I tell you something about the NPCs. For every NPC behavior in game, we use behavior trees. Behavior tree is structure of hierarchical nodes that control the flow of decision making. From up to down, the system is checking conditions and allow or not allow to enter in specific branch. If conditions are fulfilled, the tree will check the next branch, the conditions in the next branch. We use this system to implement and to implement behaviors of our characters. These trees can be extremely deep, extremely complex. So we use subtrees. We divide the tree on parts. This subtree, for example, can contain behavior like greeting, like reaction for stealing, reaction on attacking or attack, running for help and others. And from these subtrees, we create a library of behaviors. And using the behavior trees, the branches, the subtrees, for us was very easy because we can add or subtract any behavior to any character. For example, if you want someone to greet player, we simply attach to him a greeting behavior as a subtree. Because we have this library was very big and we have different behaviors for the whole development process. There were one designer that works only on this. He works only on behavior trees and on NPC behaviors. So we wanted to give the same human touch, the same human feel to NPCs as we give to our characters. So we wanted to give the player impression that human NPCs, that NPCs are also lost in war. They are also frightened. So using behavior trees, we make some assumptions. For example, not like in other games, not every character is enemy. Not every NPC is an enemy. It's natural that we met also other survivors from other buildings, and they also struggle with lack of food, lack of water, bandit attacks. So NPCs won't attack character on sight, even the soldiers, even the bandits. They adapt the behavior to your behavior, to behavior of player. For example, if you raise weapon, they ask you politely to leave it, to hide it. Even if they catch you stealing, they raise their weapon and escort you to the exit. But of course, the fight can occur. And even when the fight occurs, NPCs stop to fight when they see that your character have enough. Because we wanted to show that, like in real life, it isn't easy to pull the trigger. to kill someone. So of course there are some heartless bandits also in our game, so not every character won't kill you. And NPC also don't fight to the death, don't fight till their last breath. They all want to survive. This impression we want to give to player, so they flee if they have enough. It isn't gameplay mechanic. They won't regenerate their health and they don't come back. It's more like narrative trick. We hope the player will see in this NPC human behavior and won't be killing them even if he have a message. So we also make some work on idle behaviors of NPCs when player is an observer and don't interact with them. Initially we set patrol paths on locations that NPC patrols, but this feels very unnatural. So we design casual action system. Instead of setting paths, we define some points of interest, like inside the house, like windows, like a balcony, bridge, bed, chairs, and others. And we make small behavior trees attached to these places. So we simply run one of the behaviors once in a while, and then the character, the NPC, can, for example, go to the balcony and start smoking, or can take food from the fridge. We also choose which casual actions will be attached to which NPC. So, thanks to that, we are still able to manifest NPC presence, but the behavior feels more natural. So we also use behavior trees to script cutscenes. The script predefined scenes that player can witness on a location. It was very easy for us because we also use the behavior tree system, and we can attach the behavior tree any behavior tree to any NPC. And even if the NPC, even if our character interrupt the scene, the NPC can still react correctly because simply they change their behavior tree. Okay, because we make game quite challenging and we hope that player can establish emotional bonds between him and his characters, we can provoke player to with a moral dilemmas. So the first and everyday dilemma player we face is supplies distribution. Which character should take the meds? Which one should eat the last canned food? Should we feed the old man or the innocent kid or the young strong male who can protect the shelter? So player, our testers choose differently, and each of these decisions have its own consequences. Several times during the game, player will also encounter more serious moral dilemmas. There's a location in game called the Old House. Inside, it leaves the old man with his disabled wife, and they have a lot of supplies, a lot of food, a lot of medications. In the same time, they were defenseless. So we observe various reactions of our testers. Some of them simply take all of they can carry and ignore the old couple. Some don't steal the supplies from them, even if they also don't have the food or medicines. But I remember one female tester, which initially steal from them, take everything that she can Carrie, and she was headed to the exit. No change, there is nothing like karma in this game. And if you try that, we wanted the player judge himself. After he sees the consequences, we wanted him to ask himself that he made good or wrong. Because there is some people in the world that asking themselves this question in real life. So one of our goals was to give player the impression that work happens anytime, to anyone, also to him. Unfortunately, during the development process, the war broke out in Eastern Ukraine. For us, it was a terrible experience because we were making a game about tragedy of war and in neighborhood country, that war that actually happens. This also confirmed us that we make something serious and something important by showing the tragedy of war. Our game sends strongly pacifistic message that war is a bad thing. So player often tells us that this war mine is in the most pleasant game that we play. We are happy because despite all this, our game was warmly welcomed and appreciated both by industry and players. So we are glad that our message has been heard and understood. So to summarize, I give you some advices. I think stories are all around us. Every story you can tell using a video game, so games are no longer entertainment only for kids. They can also talk us something and provoke us to think. I think the best idea is to set the story as your base. If you want to tell the story, some story, it's good to make it your base, and around this base you should build rest of the game. You should think, but you don't have to take all the gameplay mechanics. You should think what gameplay mechanics fits the story and take only them. And because you make game, you need gameplay. Even most emotional story needs gameplay. So challenge player, so reward him for success, motivate him to play, but do this in defined before limitations, in defined before boundaries. Don't let the gameplay ruin your story. Even the ancient Greeks knows that tragedy completes comedy. In books, in movies, we have plenty of sad, thought-provoking stories. I think we need more in games industry. When I fly here, in a plane, I read in a magazine story about the hospital in Slovenia, Rania Hospital, this hospital operates during the war and treats resistance fighter. And never was never found by Germans. I think it's a great story to tell, great story to tell using game. So I encourage you to make one. But remember, so the game doesn't have to be big, doesn't have to be complex, but story you want to tell, it has to be important.